Playing in the round, that's how we rehearse normally. So it's going to be really interesting to have an audience there when we're kind of in this rehearsal type setup.
Hey, let's not hold back. Let's have a good time. We're a great rock and roll band. Let's be a great rock and roll band. This is Tentative Man. Tentative Man.
Tentative.
1, 2, 3. We're out of
here.
Crap,
I hope we don't fuck.
As just a fan of music, doing shows in the round is just always an indicator to me that I get to go and enjoy it the way that I really like to enjoy a show.
You know, I'm always in the back, so nobody could ever really see what I'm doing. It's gonna be cool to be able to see kids in the back of me and the side of me. And that's the only thing I guess I am a little weary about, that is like, you know, people are gonna just be looking at my backside, but I'll get over it.
The fact that I could look at Mark and I could look at Adam, and it's more relaxing, it's more, you know, comforting to be able to see everyone's faces.
New York City.
New York City?
I don't know if it's gonna be like whispery, quiet, and like we're gonna be different or we're gonna do the same thing. I don't know. I'm kind of curious to see how it goes.
I think it's just gonna be a totally different experience just because we're essentially playing to and for ourselves. And that's always when the best stuff comes out.
This is the first song. It's called Make Damn Sure.
New head filled up with smoke, and I've got my veins all tangled close. You're the jukebox boss you frequent, the safest place to hide. A long night spent with your most obvious weakness, you start shaking at the thought. See, you are everything I want, cause you are everything I'm not. And we like it light together just now. Too close, too close.
How close is close enough?
We like it light together just now. Too close, too close. I just want to break you down so badly.
Well, I trip over everything you say.
Well, I just want to break you down so badly.
Worst way.
But my
for the most part, a TBS show is pretty much like frenetic and chaotic and rock. So it gave us a chance to kind of like put that down for a second and try some different ways of playing these songs that were new to us.
Hey, you know what? I almost feel like we should go one more time. I think it ends too quickly.
We grew up watching like Pearl Jam Unplugged and Nirvana Unplugged and all that. So personally, it was kind of a way to live like kind of like a teenage dream.
Okay, ready?
Yep. Once we got in and started actually rehearsing the songs acoustic, we realized that they needed a little bit of reworking.
During the chorus, I was muting it. It's either that or...
Each one of us was doing something we had never done before in the band, and certainly on these songs, be it playing, you know, Adam or Eddie playing drums during a song, or playing, you know, acoustic bass or whatever. It was pretty exciting for each of us to be able to, you know, take a look at these things for the first time in a whole new way.
Okay. Maybe keep the first five in the solo.
Also going up there with the
yeah.
Songs
yeah. And no, so I'm not playing a crazy thing.
It changes the dynamic of how you work with one another, just simply because everything is already there, but you're focusing more on like the small details.
Thank you.
Dude, Jesus has a Twitter. Did you see the Jesus Twitter? There's a Jesus Twitter. Somebody has at Jesus.
All right, play
that's last. Whatever we would have had access to, instrument-wise, we probably would have tried. There was talk of timpanis. There was talk of
bell trees.
Of those like chime things. That was mostly me.
Two hits.
That was mostly my idea, but luckily that got canned. But I mean, you know, kidding aside, it was that sort of spirit, that sort of thing where we were like, let's try anything on these songs that we've written and played for years.
You know, it was a lot of fun just sitting down, playing music and trying to rearrange, you know, just have a different mission to make each song different.
We kind of started by overreaching a little bit and then kind of being like, all right, maybe that's not going to quite work here, and like scaling back a little bit and being like, all right, let's stretch a little bit, but not too far out of the comfort zone where we know we can't like kill it. You know?
Yeah, I think we found the right,
yeah,
the right medium.
Sure. That sounded pretty.
I seriously think the world is ending. My mom just texted me, OMG.
This is a text verbatim from my mom. OMG, you have to see this record store.
Maybe it's called OMG.
No one else left, but I thought it was funny.
When we released our first record, I was 18. I have a hard time listening to a lot of those songs just because being a little bit older now, like there's a lot of things that I would have done differently.
Forget me, it's not simple.
With reshaping some of the songs lyrically, as a listener, I'm a pretty lyric focused person. And it's cool because it's kind of like a reinterpretation of the message or of the story behind the song. And I think there are some cool places where he stretched out and changed things that make it really cool for someone who's a fan of the band to hear it in a new way.
Me personally, I think that he's one of the best frontmen out there. He really tries to make a show, like just what he does with a microphone and what he says on stage. And he's like a poet. He's a poet, you know.
So the vocals for that song are unlike any other song that we have. Like I have to remind myself, like chill out, like bounce it.
Yeah.
just think, oh, this man is just a few of many things to lie around, to clutter up your shelves. And I wish you weren't worth the wait, 'cause there's some things I'd like to see. I don't think that you know what you've been missing. No, I don't think that you know what you've been missing. And I dare you to forget the marks you left across my neck from those nights when we were both found out of this. The scream, I could make this obvious, and you could deny it all in one breath. Come and shrug me out of your shoulders, and I don't think that you know what you've been missing. No, I don't think that you know what you've been missing. Is that I don't think that you know. Is that I don't think that you know. Is that I don't think that you know what you've been missing.
Before you play it, can you tap the stand like conductor style? Can you be like, and then?
Oh yeah, dude, that sounds sick.
I think we all have very typical characteristics when it comes to our role in the band, like, you know, relative to what you would think a lead singer or a drummer or a bass player are like. And then we all have things that are quite contradictory to our roles. So if a bass player is usually like the shy, huge guy in the back who's just clunking around, that's certainly not me. And the same way, you know, Mark is a big guy and a powerful guy, but is also like a sensitive and gentle human being, like a nice guy. He's also, you know, he can also be a maniac.
As far as like the clown, the class clown in the band is hands down Eddie is the funniest dude. And he's always the one that's cracking jokes or making faces and stuff like that. He really makes me laugh so much.
You never sat in your apartment?
Okay. Here we go.
And your brain's like,
let's play it like it's the show with fervor and energy and focus.
The other four of us might be varying shades of crazy, and Matt is less crazy.
Yeah.
Fozzy came up with the beat that we did for Carpathia, and then Eddie started playing along, and then Adam jumped in too, and it was kind of cool because it just made this like massive sound. And made it a lot different from what it was on the album.
The shape of the song actually is in reverse, where the verses have this really pounding drum thing going on and still that quarter note pulse. But when we get to the choruses, we actually dynamically come down and smooth it out a lot, where live it's like, you know, crazy.
It's kind of cool. It's kind of got that tribal vibe to it. And I really just like the fact that I get to beat on drums.
Mark's thing is he's one of those drummers whose innate power has a lot to do with his personal sound, like his, you know, approach to the instrument.
I try and hit my drums as hard as I possibly can because I feel that might give more to the show. You know, if you feel like if you're not hitting hard enough, then it's not making the music as fun and loud and energetic as it could be.
For this setting, he mellowed it out a lot and, you know, got really into like some textural things with mallets and whatnot. But there are places when we're rehearsing where it's like, okay, come back. Cause it's just like, it's starting, you know, it's starting to go there. His arms are starting to.
Yeah.
Just like reaching more. And then there's like bits of drumsticks everywhere. So.
Yeah, cause he was playing these drumsticks called hot rod sticks. And it's like a series, it's like a bundle of little thin sticks making a thicker drumstick. So you can easily chip off like these little pieces and like at the end of rehearsal sometimes.
They usually end up in my hair.
Yeah. And you can see it on the side of Matt's hair, or on his shirt, like he has this nice coating of stick
dust.
Chunks
and
sawdust and stuff.
Say yes.
say yes, say yes, say yes, say yes. Say yes, say yes, say yes, say yes. Say yes, say yes, say yes, say yes.
Look at this show, I'm going to be playing regular electric bass, fretless bass, acoustic bass. I mean, I have a bass solo during the show. This is like a really cumulative view of everything that I like to do. So it's nice to be able to bring all of those things to the band and have them like actually make sense instead of like you're cramming it in.
Matt Rubano is one of the best bass players. He's not just like a rock and roll bass player. Like, he's very good with jazz and classical as well. So he actually went out and bought an upright bass and has been like a little kid on Christmas.
So I want to share this with everybody, actually. When I dropped off the upright this morning to get repaired, like Obi-Wan Kenobi, super old repair guy who like came out of the wood shop and his hands are covered in resin and he's all gnarly and can rip trees out of the ground, says to me, after he like breaks down what's wrong with the bass and he's gonna fix it, he looks at me and goes, you know, I really think you should have your head examined for buying an instrument like this. He's like, playing the bass, it's always gonna break, it's super heavy, can't get picked up in a cab. And, well, nobody likes music anymore.
No, hey, and I was like, hey, tweet that.
You're like,
that's 2 minutes way more than 140 letters.
Yeah.
But he was like, you should have your head examined. I was like, I'm going to rehearsal.
I haven't had the opportunity to see him walking down the street with it because it has this little wheel on the bottom, so he just kind of rolls it. I would like a picture of that.
ladies and gentlemen, Judgment Day.
We've been touring for so many years. It kind of feels good to come home and get together and do something really different and special.
Having people come to the shows that are really invested and in love with the music, I think that's so, so cool.
Everybody is just personality-wise so different, and I think that's what makes Taking Back Sunday what it is, and that's how we get the sound that we get.
I think we'll all certainly learn something from doing this and about one another too, because you see someone doing something totally different, grabbing a new instrument, it opens up the possibilities of what you can do.
I think everybody going on in the future, I think everybody will be more focused on those little details for the newer material.
Thank you all so very much.